It's such a beautiful country. It is a crime. There is so much corruption.
It's really everywhere.
Indonesia has one of the last remaining tropical forests. If you talk about Indonesia as the producer of oxygen of the world, everyone actually is the victim. We need that tropical forest to be protected. We need that tropical forest not to be the source of corruption. Corruption is everywhere. Corruption has been likened to a disease that is really eating the whole country and suffocating us. It hampers the country's ability to serve its people.
The corruption is so chronic here in Indonesia that the public services that should be the rights of the civilians, of the people, are not being given. All the people in middle economic class, they don't have the money to pay the bribe or the embezzlement and doesn't have proper public services. All the public officials, most of them are pretty corrupt.
For example, the family of the mayor, they have more than 40 luxurious cars. They go abroad, they buy in high-class boutique, but within 20 kilometers, there are people who cannot eat.
So I think there is an acknowledgement from the government that we have a problem. You actually have young people, and most of them are young people, ready to put their life in danger, fighting against corruption.
Where are you, Mr. President?
It has become very personal to me to fight corruption because, you know, I'm just sick of these people getting whatever they want just because they have the authority.
So that is why it's very risky. They have money, they have political networking, and they have power to intervene. We should use the law as our tool to fight with the authoritarian regime.
For me, I just want to obey this constitution. I don't care who you are. It's very important for this country.
So ICW is the most important organization working on this issue head on.
In ICW, all of us is young people below 40. They are lawyers, teachers, mathematicians, biologists. We have a different background, but we have the same dream about how to use our skills to combat corruption.
But more importantly, they also work on a minute, real, practical level. They look at papers, they look at numbers, they look at budget, they look at planning, they look at implementation.
We investigate the case, we find the facts, we use scientific methods, and then we do press conference about that. So we really trying a different strategy. We are campaigning, we are watchdog, but we also have recommendations that can be implemented.
One day Indonesia will no corruption.
Indonesia need ICW.
This is not about yourself or your own country. This is about the whole world. We have to work hand in hand.
For the sake of the people, I want it to be a better place for all of us.
Indonesia Corruption Watch.
Corruption is a huge issue for Kenyans because they know that it's holding us back. I think that Kenya is at a tipping point. If you look around you, you can see a lot of skyscrapers, new roads, and that kind of thing. By 2006, the number of kids in primary school had doubled. So my argument has always been that the hardware of Kenya is working properly. The hardware is you know, the tables, the chairs, the roads, the schools, and everything. The software is the glue that holds a nation together. It's the sense of identity that unites us. The software of Kenya failed. The 2007-2008 election showed us that the singular, most belligerent identity is the ethnic, tribal identity.
In less than maybe 2 years, there was a fight now between the people from here and the people from over there.
You have a situation where people from different tribes have a very low sense of trust between each other. So our diversity, which is what makes us strong, has become a weakness.
I get to Mr. Kizongo.
And so we try to work on those issues. So in this day and age, we can begin to debate one of Kenya's deepest malaise, which is corruption.
Asante sana.
Yes. Thank you very much. Karibu sana madale.
Kenya has a strong state, but a weak nation. And that has potentially got dire consequences for the country. The real impact of corruption is not in the money lost. Even though for media it makes good press, the most insidious effect of corruption in a society like ours is that it causes key governance institutions to be degraded. You know, police, civil service, judiciary, all these constitutional organizations that are essential for our democracy lose their effectiveness. So it is far more dangerous here in Kenya because we face the most ideologically coherent, determined enemy Kenya has ever faced in the form of Al-Shabaab. Al-Shabaab is killing Kenyans. And there's nothing that is more illustrative of the deadly effects of corruption than what Al-Shabaab is doing, because they buy their way through the system, because our institutions have been hollowed out by corruption. And it poses a very severe threat to the stability of Kenya.
We have to look at all those factors and then...
Whenever one fights corruption, in a country where corruption has become systemic, you make enemies. So in continuing this fight against corruption, always making noise about it, always writing articles about it, eventually, I had to flee into exile. So people often ask me, are you being too idealistic? But it is we Kenyans, we Africans, who are going to solve our own problems. No one is going to come and solve them for us. And only idealistic people fight corruption.
This is the kind of poverty, the way people sell in the midst of garbage. And this whole area of Luanda is basically a pile of rubbish. And people are not allowed to protest for living under these circumstances. I'm an investigative journalist from Angola. And I've also been known as a human rights defender. We have looters in power. We have criminals in power. And that needs to change. Corruption has become an impediment for democracy in the country. And corruption has been fueling also human rights abuses. They're so inextricably linked. David Saleh is an activist who, since 2011, has been taking to the streets to protest against corruption and more than 30 years of power by President Dos Santos. So He's been paying a high price. How is it possible when we talk about how resources in the country are squandered and are not provided for the people's well-being? Any complaints about that is met with repression by the government.
The message he's wearing, it says, Angolan people, there is no government, but simply a gang of thieves that rule the country.
Quite often we want to project a better image of Africa. And we struggle between what some of the African leaders do and what people do on the ground, which is beautiful, which is commendable, and should take us towards development. But nothing gets done in Angola if it doesn't go through briberies, through all sorts of corruption schemes. Something is fundamentally wrong in this country. We have the resources to make our countries far more beautiful than Europe, than America. Why are we suffering and why are we dependent? So I'm here to ensure that as a citizen, I do my job right. And that is my way also of contributing, providing social leadership by being an influential opinion maker that says what needs to be said. I cannot see myself living in this country oblivious to the abuses taking place around me. I want that to change. So MAC Angola has one very clear goal: to ensure that the public understands that corruption is a crime. In 1999, I wrote an article exposing the president as a corrupt dictator, and I was jailed for that. It is not about bad-mouthing the leaders, but ensuring that at some point in Africa, the people that have good intentions, goodwill, and skills take precedence over those who are bad people, bad rulers, who want to keep us down. We must rise. We must take a stand. We must beat the drum for change.
Sergei Magnitsky was killed for his ideals. He was killed because he believed in the law. He was killed because he loved his people. He was killed because he loved Russia. In 2007, 25 officers from the Moscow Interior Ministry raided my offices in Moscow and seized all of our documents. At the time, my firm, Hermitage Capital Management, was the largest foreign investor in Russia. Following the raids, we discovered that our investment holding companies had been stolen using the documents seized by the police. We were terrified that the police were involved in such a corrupt scandal, and we looked around to hire the smartest lawyer we could in Russia, and that was a young man named Sergei Magnitsky. After Sergei investigated for a number of months, he discovered that the purpose of this scheme was first to try to steal our money, which they didn't succeed in doing, but second, to steal $230 million of taxes that we had paid to the Russian government, which they did succeed in doing.
For Sergei, when he understand that it's not the Hermitage money that has been stolen, it's the money that has been stolen from his pensioning mother, from his kids, from him as a taxpayer as well, it is became his war.
And then Sergei testified against the corrupt police officers involved. We had encouraged him and all of our other lawyers to leave the country. Everyone else had left, but Sergei refused to leave. He said, "I've not done anything wrong. The police have, and I'm going to stay and I'm going to testify against them."
Он сказал: "Я живу в этой стране. Это моя страна. Я не хочу, чтобы здесь происходили такие вещи и происходило такое беззаконие. Я буду с этим бороться."
1 month after Sergei testified against the corrupt police officers, the same officers he testified against arrested him in front of his wife and two children, put him in pretrial detention, where he was then tortured to get him to withdraw his testimony.
Нам не разрешали свидания. Следовательно, не разрешал свидания.
The purpose of all this was to get him to withdraw his testimony against the police officers and to sign a false confession to say that he had stolen the $230 million, and he did so in my instructions. Сергей refused.
Вот Магнитский жил так, как писал Солженицын. Не верь, не бойся, не проси. Я думаю, что он герой.
He wrote 450 complaints in his 358 days in detention, spelling out exactly what happened to him, who did what to him, where, how, when, and why. And as a result of this, we have the most well-documented trail of human rights abuse that's happened in Russia in the last 35 years. And we expected that that would bring justice, but it didn't. He lost 40 pounds, and he was diagnosed as having pancreatitis and gallstones. Instead of operating on him, they moved him to a prison without medical facilities for 4 months. He and his lawyers wrote more than 20 different requests begging for medical attention.
Полтора дня в камере, в которой я содержался, пол был залит канализационной водой, несмотря на требования по то, чтобы нас перевели в другую камеру.
Ваше ходатайство рассмотрено, его удовлетворение происходит.
It's a moment of despair for Sergei. It's a moment of, I think, that he, as a lawyer, understood that there is no law.
The night of November 16th, 2009, Sergei's health completely broke down. He went into critical condition that night. So they put him in an ambulance and sent him over to a different prison. But when he arrived at the new prison, instead of putting him in the emergency room, they put him in an isolation cell, they chained him to a bed, and 8 riot guards with rubber batons beat him until he died. He was 37 years old. He left a wife and 2 children.
Мы все в шоке, конечно. До сих пор не верю, что это случилось.
Sergei's story is now reaching a very wide audience. Sergei's name is on legislation in America and Europe, which will impose visa sanctions and asset freezes on human rights abusers in Russia and elsewhere around the world. And Sergei's family is traveling around the world now, meeting with politicians, accepting awards, and spreading his story.
Всё в мире нас поддержит и продолжают поддерживать сейчас, то есть люди хотят, чтобы правда восторжествовала во всем мире.
He still stood up to, you know, the corruption in Russia and really fought for what he thought was right.
Недавно видела человека, он сказал, что я жив благодаря Сергею, что смерть Сергея все-таки привела к тому, что какие-то изменения к лучшему произошли, во всяком случае, в плане вот содержания в тюрьме, хотя это не всегда так. Я вначале это сказала, я хотела бы еще поблагодарить всех людей, которые помнят Сергея, потому что я думаю, что пока о человеке помнят, он жив.